Hello students, today we'll be studying about milk, its classification, composition, processing, storage, nutritive value and storage tips. And we start with the first module, and that is about the composition of milk. Now milk is defined as the secretion of the mammary glands from mammals, and it is the one which exclusively sustains us for the first few months of life. We will start with the composition of milk. Milk is chiefly composed of water, which is about 87 to 88%, and around 12 to 13% is made up of other solids. Now out of this, the major solid which is of economic value is fat, which is about 3 to 4%, and the rest of the solids are made up of proteins, which is again 3 to 4%, and lactose, or what we call a carbohydrate, around 5%, and the other solids include the minerals, the various salts, etc. Now to start with, I am going to tell you about the carbohydrate component of milk, which is the chief carbohydrate of milk is lactose, and it is very important from biological point of view because it is composed of one part of glucose and one part of galactose, and this is important for the formation of the myelin sheath. Now this lactose is acted upon by the microbes of the intestine and is fermented to lactic acid, which reduces the pH of the stomach, which helps in the absorption of calcium. Now lactose is the sugar which cannot be added to any milk artificially. Now coming to the protein part of the milk is about 3 to 4%. The protein is chiefly made up of two components, the two major components of protein, which is casein and the whey proteins. Casein contributes to about 80% of the major proteins of the milk, and they are the solids, and casein is composed of along with the protein component casein, it is found in the form of calcium caseinate or citrate caseinate, etc., because it is in combination with calcium, phosphorus and citrate. Now this casein gets separated from the milk upon the acidification of milk to a pH of about 4.6. It can be separated from the milk, and this can also be coagulated by the use of the enzyme renin, mostly commercially for the preparation of cheese. Now the 20% of the protein of the milk is what we call the whey proteins, and the important whey proteins are lactoalbumin, lactoglobulin and immunoglobulins. Now whey proteins are more well hydrated, and they cannot be separated from the milk upon acidification, but they get separated from the milk or coagulated from the milk when they are heated to very high temperatures. Now this whey proteins have a very important role to play because they have very good biological value, and therefore they can be separated by the ultrafiltration technique or the diafiltration technique commercially. Now apart from the proteins, we also have other components like enzymes which are present in milk, and we have like alkaline phosphatase. Now apart from this, we also have peptones in the milk as protein components. Now coming to the fat of the milk, which is very very important economically, and this fat ranges between 3 to 4% in milk. The fat component of milk is around 3 to 4%, and it is of great economic value. Now this is in whole milk, it is made up of fat soluble vitamins and also certain pigments such as beta carotene and xanthophylls. Most of the milk fat is triglycerides, that is about 95%. Now in this major portion, that is 65% is of the saturated type, 25% is monounsaturated fatty acids and about 10% is polyunsaturated fatty acids. Now, coming to the other components, apart from carbohydrates, fats and proteins, now the most important components of milk is what we call the vitamins and minerals. Now, vitamins, there are two types of vitamins which are found in milk, the fat soluble vitamins as well as the water soluble vitamins. Now, under the fat soluble vitamins, we have vitamin A, retinol, beta carotene, as well as we have vitamins E, D and K, but it's an excellent source of vitamin A. Now, vitamin D is found but in very small quantities, and most often milk is the food in which vitamin D is fortified with. And then we have water soluble vitamins, which include it is a very good source of thiamine, especially riboflavin, to small extent niacin, folic acid, pantothenic acid and also biotin, vitamin B6 and vitamin B12. Now, coming to minerals, as we all know, milk is known as a food which is high in calcium. So, this calcium is also found in the form of calcium, phosphorus, potassium, and all these are found in small quantities, but calcium is found to a larger extent, and milk has very, very minute amounts of iron. So, it's not a good source of iron, as well as in vitamins, it is not a good source of vitamin C. Now, this calcium is in a stable condition in milk, basically because, as I told earlier, it is in combination with salts such as citrates, phosphates and in the form of calcium phosphorus. Therefore, it is very easily absorbed and assimilated in the intestines of the man, and it is taken up for the utilization and deposition into the bones. Now, other components include small amounts of enzymes and peptones, etc. Now, we divide the milk products into basically two categories, the non-fermented milk products and fermented milk products. Now, I'm going to start with the non-fermented milk products. The first is the whey protein concentrate, which gets separated from milk through a process of ultrafiltration method, and it has this whey protein concentrate has very high biological value and protein efficiency ratio. So, it is separated from the milk in concentrations of 20% to 80%, and it is used for adding to various products to increase their biological value and also the protein value. The next product is what we call the skim milk. Now, skim milk is the one from where the fat has been removed to an extent of 0.5% to 2%. And mostly this milk is higher in calcium but lower in fat, and since the fat is removed, it needs to be fortified with vitamins A and D in order to maintain the value of these vitamins. Then next we have the whole milk. In this whole milk is just the natural milk from which nothing has been subtracted or nothing has been added. Now, next we have what we call the standardized milk. The standardized milk is the one where the fat content is standardized to 4.5%, and it is a mix of buffalo milk and skim milk. Then next we have toned milk. Toned milk is the one which we get in packets everywhere. Now, toned milk, the protein content is standardized to about 3.5%, and solids, not fat, to about 8.5%. And then this toned milk, it is made up of buffalo milk and also a mix of skim milk powder. Then next we have pasteurized milk. Pasteurized milk is where the milk is subjected to a very mild heat treatment, which helps in destroying the bacteria and increasing the shelf life of the milk. Now, this is one of the most popular heat treatment commonly applied to milk. Then next we have what we call the sterilized milk. Sterilized milk is where the heat treatment that is applied is very, very strong, a very high temperature is utilized to make sure that all the bacteria in the milk are destroyed, completely destroyed. Then next one, which the milk which we find in the Tetra Paks is called as the ultra high temperature processed milk. Now in this milk, the milk is subjected to a temperature of 135 degrees and above for a very, very brief period of time, where it makes sure that all the bacteria and the spores are destroyed. Now this milk can be safely stored unrefrigerated up to 120 days or 3 months from the date of manufacture, and once it is opened, it needs to be refrigerated and utilized within 5 days, and this is available to us in the form of Tetra Paks. Then we have other varieties of milk. Now in this, what we call, we have evaporated milk. Evaporated milk is where the moisture content of the milk is removed to an extent of 50 to 60% by various methods, and the milk is concentrated and it becomes thick, and it is a sterilized product. Now as per the Prevention of Food Adulteration Act, it should have a solid milk solid content of about 26%, and minimum percentage of fat should be around 8%. Now another version of evaporated milk is what we call the sweetened condensed milk. Now in this product we add sugar. Now this product, to which sugar is added, is not sterile because of the addition of sugar, but at the same time it has a longer preservative life because of the addition of high concentration of sugar. Now here the amount of sugar is present to an extent of 65%, and it should contain 9% fat and 31% milk solids. Now this product, as I said earlier, is not sterilized, but it is preserved by the addition of high amounts of sugar, and it is mostly made with skimmed milk. Now organic milk is the one which is becoming popular nowadays, here where the milk is obtained from the either buffaloes or cows which have grazed on pasture, to which no chemical pesticides or fertilizers or agrochemicals have been added. Now we have malted milk. It is also powdered gruel. Most importantly, you know this malted milk as a product such as Horlicks or Complan or Maltova or Milo, etc., where it is a gruel which is made from a mixture of malted barley, wheat flour and whole milk powder, which is evaporated until it forms a powder. Then we have lactose free milk for the people who are sensitive or allergic to the lactose, the sugar which is found in milk. Now this modified milk is made by filtering regular milk to remove half of the lactose. Then the enzyme lactase is then added to the milk so that it is converted to form into simpler forms which can easily be absorbed. Now we get most commonly different varieties of flavored milk, now to which some flavoring and sugar is added, and here the fat percentage is reduced to 1%. Now dry milk or the milk powders as we popularly know them are made with whole milk or skim milk, where they are dehydrated to an extent of 97% moisture has been removed, and these are different methods are used to dry these milk powders. It can be vacuum dried, it can be spray dried, it can be roller dried, etc. Now it is milk powder is made by evaporating the water from the milk, as I said earlier, and this powder is in skim milk. It can be reconstituted easily by mixing it with water at any temperature, because it doesn't have fat, it mixes very easily. On the other hand, whole milk powder, because of the fat content, it takes a little longer to get mixed, or it needs to be mixed only with hot water. Now both skim milk powder reconstituted or whole milk powder reconstituted milk has to be treated as the normal milk because it has similar composition of skim milk and whole milk. Now, these powders, if they are stored properly, can be used for a very long period of time. Now, we make Indian sweets like, for example, gulab jamun, barfis, etc. with a product which is called khoa. It is a semi-solid which is obtained from milk by evaporating the milk in open pans with continuous stirring, and the end product is only 20% of the weight of the original milk. Now, we have another product which is popular in the form of a sweet which is called rabri. Now, this is a concentrated sweetened product which is comprising of several layers of milk, or what we call the clotted cream, to which sugar is added when it reaches one third of its concentration. Now, another product which is very popular is what you call chhena in the north, or paneer. Now, it is a major heat and acid coagulated product where to milk we add either lime juice or vinegar and coagulate casein and separate it from milk, and it is used in Indian sweets like rasmalai, rasgulla, etc. Now, we have most popular dessert ice cream. It's a frozen dairy product chiefly made up from various products of milk such as whole milk, skim milk, cream, butter, condensed milk products or dried milk products. It also contains other products like sugar, stabilizers, emulsifier, flavoring material and color, and certain amount of air is incorporated to make the ice cream very light and creamy. Now, we also have a product called cream which is used for making into a whipped cream for icing toppings, as well as it is used for adding to the coffee, etc. This cream is the high fat component which is separated from whole milk as a result of the creaming process. It has various concentration of fat found in it, and the cream with different concentration is used for different purposes. We have light coffee cream with 18 to 30% butter fat, light whipping cream with 30 to 36% butter fat, then we have heavy cream which has more than 36% fat, and we also have something called as half and half, where it is diluted with non-fat milk which is 10.5% butter fat. Now, the whipping cream is pre-packaged and sold in the market for the purpose of using it on directly for icing the cakes and other products. Now, we will talk about the fermented milk products. Now, in the fermented milk products, the first product that I am going to talk about, which is commercially very important, is the butter. Now, butter, as we all know, is supposed to be high in fat. So, it contains about 80% fat, and rest of the 20% is made up of moisture and other protein components. Now, it is made mostly from fermented sweet or sour cream. Butter is a concentrated form of fluid milk produced through the churning of the curd or the sour cream or the sweet cream, where the solid part butter is separated and what is left behind is the buttermilk. Now, this buttermilk is slightly watery and yellowish in color because it contains certain pigments. Even butter, the natural butter, is slightly creamish or yellowish in color because of the beta carotene and the xanthophyll pigments present in them, which are fat soluble. Now, butter generally, if it is not stored properly, spoils very fast because of the butyric and caproic acids, which undergo a process called as the rancidity. The second fermented milk product, which is very, very popular across India, is what we call ghee. Ghee is a type of clarified butter, which is prepared by simmering the butter and removing the residue. The texture, the color and the taste of the butter, the ghee, depends upon the quality of the butter and the duration of the boiling. Now, the next product is buttermilk. As I said, after it is a fermented milk product which is the liquid which is left behind after the separation of the butter from the cream. It is beneficial because it contains probiotic microbes, and also the fat content of buttermilk is very, very low when compared to milk or curd. Now, next product which is popular in India, a fermented product, is curd. Now, it is prepared by heating the milk or boiling the milk and cooling it to body temperature and adding about 6 to 10% of what we call starter culture of the previous curd. Now, after 6 to 8 hours, the milk undergoes the process of fermentation due to the action of the bacteria, as well as there is a fall in the acidity to about 1%. Now, this fall in the acidity leads to the coagulation of casein, and what we call the curd is set. Now, this curd is much easily digested compared to milk, and it contains more B vitamins than milk. It has a higher percentage of folic acid, and it is used daily as a supplement in our daily diet, as well as in the cooking process for marinating, and also adding as a souring agent in the cookery. Now, yogurt is a variety of curd which is more popular in the Western cuisine. Now, here yogurt is slightly different from curd because of two things. One, the components in which whole milk, low fat skim milks, and even cream is added to make yogurt. And also in the production, the culture which is used, the culture of the bacteria is different. It is made up of Streptococcus thermophilus and Lactobacillus acidophilus. It is added to pasteurized milk and it is incubated at a temperature of 42 to 46 degrees. Now, fermented milk everywhere is useful for a wide variety of treatment of disorders of the stomach, such as colitis, constipation, diarrhea, gastroenteritis, diabetes, and also hypercholesterolemia. Now, one product which is made from curd, which is very popular across the Western India, is what we call Shrikhand in the states of Maharashtra and in Gujarat. It is nothing but concentrated form of curd from which the moisture is removed, to which sugar powder, sugar, and flavoring agents are added, and it is eaten by these people as a dessert. Now, one product which is popular across the world is what we call cheese. Now, cheese is made up of only casein. Varieties of cheese are differentiated according to their flavor, their texture, the type of milk, the salts, and also seasonings added, and the type of bacteria and yeast and molds which are utilized for ripening the cheese in the process of the manufacturing and processing. Now, this is where we are going to stop with the fermented milk products. Now, we are going to talk about the processing of milk, because milk is highly perishable because of the high moisture content, but it is such a valuable food item that we need to preserve it for longer use. Therefore, we use different processing techniques to make it safe for usage in the long run. Now, processing is done to produce milk of low bacterial count, good flavor, and sufficient keeping quality. Now, the various processing techniques which are used, I will go in the order, are clarification, homogenization, pasteurization, fortification. Now, the first process is of clarification and clearing. Clarification, as the word suggests, is the removal of small particles of straw, hair, and also fine small bacteria based on density through a process called as bacteriofugation, centrifugal separation of microorganisms from milk. The optimal temperature at which the milk is subjected to clarification is between 55 to 60 degrees centigrade. Through the process of microfiltration, the bacterial count of the milk can be reduced to an extent of 99.5% to 99.99%. The second process is homogenization. It is carried out to prevent the creaming or the separation of the butter fat from rising to the top of the container of the milk when it is made to stand. The process of homogenization permanently emulsifies the fine fat globules by a method that pumps the milk through fine micro holes under high pressure and at a particular temperature, and this instrument is called as a homogenizer. Now, it homogenization mechanically increases the number and reduces the size of the fat globules in the milk. The size is reduced to 1/10 of their original size, resulting in the milk that maintains more uniform composition with improved body and texture and a more whiter appearance. Now, it has also a very rich flavor, and it whenever the curd is set, it is more digestible. Now, the third process and the most common and very widely used process is called pasteurization. It is relatively a mild heat treatment which is sufficient to destroy the disease causing microorganisms and inactivate the enzymes to extend the shelf life of the milk. Now, this immediately should be followed by cooling of the product to the temperature sufficiently low to check the growth of the microorganisms which are resistant to the temperatures being used. Now, pasteurization causes minimum sensory and nutritive changes in the milk. Now, some vitamin levels are reduced, especially the heat labile vitamins like thiamine and whatever small quantities of vitamin C. Now, different pasteurization techniques are used. The first one is called low temperature, longer time process, where the milk is heated to a temperature of 65 degrees for 30 minutes, and it is also called as the holding method or the batch method. Now, we have something called as high temperature, short time method, where the milk is heated to a temperature of 72 degrees centigrade for a period of 15 seconds only, and it is followed by a rapid cooling to 10 degrees centigrade. It is also called as the continuous method or the flash pasteurization. Then we have ultra high temperature, which I spoke to you before. The temperature used here is 149 for a second or 93.4 degrees for 3 seconds. Now, these are the three methods of pasteurization. Now, we have something very important is the fortification, where it consists of the addition of the fat soluble vitamins, especially vitamin A and D, to the whole milk is optional, but most amount of vitamin A and D is added to low fat milk and non fat milk. This is done before pasteurization. Now, sometimes milk is also fortified with extra amount of protein to increase the milk solids. We are going to talk about the nutritional aspect, the uses of milk, and the storage tips. Now, the nutritional aspects, we conclude with very important aspect that milk is an excellent source of good quality protein with a very high biological value, which is about over 90%, and also high protein efficiency ratio, where the lysine content of milk is very abundant, and this can be used to supplement the cereal diet. Now, it is made up of easily digestible fat, and it contains a high percentage of essential fatty acids, that is linoleic acid, linolenic acid and arachidonic acid, which are essential for the body. Now, it is the only substance that contains lactose, which is essential for the synthesis of myelin sheath because of the presence of galactose in its composition. Now, this lactose also favors the growth of lactobacillus in the intestine, and it decreases the pH, thus it favors the absorption of calcium much more better from the intestines. It also increases the permeability or the transfer of small intestine for calcium ions. Now, it's a poor source of iron and vitamin C, and it's not a very good source of niacin, but an excellent source of tryptophan, which can be converted to niacin biosynthetically in the body. Now, it's a major source of essential mineral like calcium and the vitamin riboflavin, which is not easily found in other foods. Now, as you all know, milk is a very, very essential food item, which is a part of our daily diet, and we cannot do without milk as a part of our diet, because as I've just now summed up, it is very important nutritionally, a good source of protein, calcium, and good amount of fats, and important vitamins like riboflavin and beta carotene and retinol also. And it can be used for in multiple ways in our everyday diet for children as well as for adults and for geriatrics, because it is a complete food. It provides proteins, carbohydrates, vitamins and minerals. And when a person is unable to eat any solids, milk as such as a beverage or any product made out of milk is an essential component of the diet. So, this is the conclusion for the lesson on milk.